Welcome back to the University of Detroit Mercy Lacrosse Conversations with head coach Chris Colon. My name is Greg Norman, your host. Welcome back, Chris. And I guess it'll be our last conversation for this year. We've got a big game coming up against Cleveland State on the road, coming off a really tough loss to Bellarmine. And a couple of, you know, composite scores, 20-8, both in the last two losses. And I guess we'll just have to start with, talk a little bit about Cleveland State and we'll come back to the Bellarmine.
It's going to be interesting. Cleveland State's a great team. They're growing up. You know, there are natural Horizon League with Robert Morris, Cleveland State, and Detroit are Horizon League partners. That's what is our natural conference that all of our other sports play in. So we have a lot of pride in this game, and we'd sure like, since we beat Robert Morris, we'd sure like to beat Cleveland State and be kind of the best in our Horizon League conference, because, you know, as conferences, you know, there's always talk of conference realignment. Like, you kind of don't know what's going to happen year in and year out. Like, we're pretty sure we're going to be in this Atlantic Sun this year, next year. We could be beyond that, but we don't know. We actually don't think so. But we always know we're going to be playing these three teams, so we take a lot of pride in this game. It was a really heated game last year. We are expecting a heated game this year. You got to go play in their bubble. That is an interesting challenge. It's an interesting place to play. You know, once your eyes get used to it, it's fine, but it gets really loud in there, and the fans they do a great, you know, fan experience there. So it's a pretty exciting place to play, and you have to be ready for it.
Because you're saying it's a tough experience because of lighting being poor lighting.
It's okay. I mean, the good news is we've gone there at times where we've gone there day of. I would say that makes it difficult, but this time we're going there the day before, so we'll have a practice in there. So I don't think that's a valid excuse once you've got some time that your goalies and everybody can see some shots the day before. I think it's, I will say, if it's a day of experience, as we've done sometimes in the past, that's a little bit of an advantage. But, you know, by the middle of the first quarter, these kids, my old eyes don't do great in it, but I think some of the kids should be just fine. But with practice, I don't think it's anything except it's going to be a little bit warmer. And God knows it's, you know, still 30 degrees out and snowing. So we're happy to be playing inside in kind of a atmosphere where we can work up a sweat.
UDM has had an alliance and affiliation, obviously, with the Horizon League in all of their sports, the exception of lacrosse, men's lacrosse. Obviously,
and women.
Women, yep. They're in the MAC, so yep. I get that. What would it take for the Horizon League to have lacrosse exclusively?
Well, I'll tell you, you know, we'd have to bring in some outside teams. Obviously, independent, you'd like to have around seven teams in a conference, because six is the minimum for an NCAA bid. Seven is you know, you have one for as a little bit of extra insurance. But, you know, we have some administrators that are involved. I know Cleveland State's very active, Robert Morris's, but then, you know, you've got all those other teams that don't sponsor lacrosse that might have to do some work or put some financial backing behind it for league games and things like that. So that, I'm not sure where the temperature is. I know we've got some pretty dedicated administrators at the three schools, but they've got to convince all the ones that are, you know, don't carry lacrosse. And, you know, as we've talked of coaches and administrators, you know, this might be a great, if we did carry lacrosse, some of these schools like Youngstown and schools that have talked about adding lacrosse in the past that have women's teams, you know, it might be that little thing that puts them over the edge to add lacrosse. And that's what we're trying to do.
Obvious question then, follow up would be, can you compete in the ASUN?
We're trying our best. I mean, it, you know, when you've got, you know, we just saw the best three teams, three of the best four teams. I would say Utah's the fourth best team. And, you know, Utah and Air Force have a completely different model of an athletic department than really the Horizon League schools or us, especially. I can speak to us. There's some situations at Jacksonville. There's some situations in some of the Southern teams that make us very different. So, we go at it as hard as we can. I think if you take a look at what Bellarmine has done, if we want to talk about Bellarmine, you know, we have had a good run against Bellarmine. They brought in a new president who came from Loyola. She's very lacrosse centric. She understands what that can bring to the university. So they've brought their budget up to what other folks are doing and kind of their processes also. So their budget processes and kind of how they approach lacrosse and the sport. And they're more in line with, I think, those, Air Force, Utah, than they are with the Horizon League schools. So, you know, I think if we're going to stay in the ASUN long-term, we have to make some choices about how we're going to go at it. You know, we as a coaching staff and as kids, we're going to go as hard as we can, no matter what the situation is. That's been our style, no matter what. We don't care what we have, what we don't have. We're going to try to give the best effort and project, product we can. So, you know, we're going to try our best no matter what. And you know, I think if we stay in the ASUN, I think it would be really good. You know, it's mid-major stuff. We're building into it. We're getting better recruits every year because of it. And as we grow and as some of our young guys develop, some of our better recruits come in, like we'll grow into it. We did it with the MAC and we'll do it here.
The sentiment's appreciated, but at the same time, resources are also provide opportunity. And without those opportunities and without the resources to provide those opportunities, it's more of a public relations slogan than it is in reality. Of course, you're going to go at it hard. I understand those things. But doesn't the university and doesn't the league have some responsibility for parity? You think of high school, that's the first thing you think about is realignment to make sure that it's fair.
Well, I can tell you, Greg, that's out of my control. So
okay. No, that's fair. I get that.
We teach kids to just compartmentalize and take care of your own responsibility. So that's what I do, right? Like I can control, I make the statements on what I communicate and that's all I can do. And other than that, I can work and give the best damn experience I can give for these kids. So that's all I'm going to do.
No, and I get that. And not every cupcake is built the same way. So I understand the sort of the approach to that, but it from a coaching standpoint, it continues to make you a magician to some extent, rather than maybe, you know, a hardened developer and planner, because sometimes you're limited, but that's for another day.
Right.
Cleveland State provides.
We'll talk about that over the summer. How about we'll do a summer update?
Yeah, no, I get that. It's not, you know, in the world of, you know, this launched into, you think of all the stuff that's being built at the NCAA levels for football and all the rest of it, to sort of this explosion. It's, you got to wonder how long before NCAA sports are really almost with NIL, almost professional. And it does create caverns of inequity across the landscape because it's not fair.
Yeah, we can talk about, we can do that. We can make that our own show over the summer. I would love to talk about NIL and what it's doing to college sports. And and even within athletic departments have to make choices for the vast majority of them, you know, besides the Power Five, right? So, and even the Power Five guys, you know, I would say that if you're a lacrosse player at Michigan or, you know, you might, while you're getting probably NIL money and things like that, that are well above anything in that I would ever have imagined as a college athlete in the Big Ten, I would say, they probably feel like they don't get anything compared to football, right? So,
right. No,
you know, it's a crazy world, and I don't know which way it's going. But I'm just going to worry about what's on my plate and doing the best I can be within this context, because this is my where I am and this is where I'm going to be.
Season's over on Saturday. Hopefully, you know you get an opportunity. You get a great banquet. You get a few weeks off. I'm assuming there's got to be some decompression just to kind of get, or is it recruiting right off the bat?
Yeah, I mean, I start recruiting. I mean, I go watch high school games immediately, right? That's what I do, but I find that pretty relaxing. I enjoy, and I tried to go out to some places that you wouldn't expect. But I'm out, you know, during the week, every day at 3 o'clock, I see my kids, and then I maybe take one of them with me, maybe not, and we go watch lacrosse. So, I don't really take a break. I'm gonna probably take a break. I never do. So right. I start my first recruiting trip in May and down to Texas. And but again, I don't think watching a lacrosse game is very hard work.
It probably goes why you spend some time with the bass guitar, you know, on the weekends just to kind of clear the fog and kind of move forward. So
yeah, thank God for that.
Well, good. Well, listen, we wish you the best at Cleveland State. Hopefully you get the win, kind of even it up a little bit. And other than that, it's been a good season. I appreciate you spending all your time with us.
Greg, and thanks so much for all you do, adding so much value to the university for the kids and giving them what they probably deserve. And I really appreciate it. So thanks so much for everything you do.
Thanks, Chris. Welcome back. We're talking with John Losey, the longtime University of Detroit Mercy Titan lacrosse broadcaster. John, appreciate talking to you today. This is we should have had an opportunity to do the Bellarmine game on Saturday. Weather was Mother Nature kind of slipped in. And I guess 7 minutes left in the game. They called it at a pretty good point because UAD was not playing very well. Ooh. So this will be our last segment for this year. I'll get to you in just a second, get all this in. But I really appreciate the season so far, and it's been fun. This will be our last segment until next spring. So welcome, and tough way to finish the season for both the school and for us.
Yeah. You know, it's kind of how the season's been, right? I mean, it's been choppy and bus rides for the team and travel and losses. And for us, you know, yeah, it was a bummer. I mean, you know, it wasn't a good game and Lightning ended it. But, you know, I think for us, you know, we had things to talk about the seniors. I think, you know, I feel bad about that because I had some things and I know some of those kids, you know, personally. You know, from their playing days here in, you know, in Michigan. And, you know, it was a total bummer, but, you know, we can't control. That's my big thing, Greg.
Yeah, for sure. Well, they head to their last game at Cleveland State. We talked to Chris earlier a little bit about talking about the Horizon League. UD is in the Horizon League for most of their sports, with the exception of women's lacrosse, which is in the MAC, and certainly the men are in the ASUN. And one of the conversations about that is that sort of with Robert Morris, Cleveland State, they get the chance to win this game, that they kind of become the Horizon League champions.
Yeah.
And so the conversation kind of drifted towards how long would it take for the Horizon League to have lacrosse? And then the follow-up to that would be, would it make more sense to play in a program in a league, not unlike the MAC from last year, where the field was a little more, you know, was a little more equity between the programs? Because if you look at Air Force and Utah and you look at some of the teams in the league, it doesn't necessarily measure up from a value standpoint within the athletic department.
No, I agree. I mean, I think, you know, if you could take Cleveland State, you know, UDM and Robert Morris, and then plug in maybe Queens and Linderwood, you know, I think that's got something there. And if you can get an automatic bid, you know, I think you got something cooking. Because, you know, look at it logistically. I mean, it just, there's no sense in, you know, in UDM traveling to Utah or traveling to Air Force or, you know, even Mercer for that matter. I think it, you know, it really defines what you're looking for in a player. You know, I think it just makes things so much easier if they were able to do something like that.
I never get a chance to quote Branch Rickey, the old baseball
producer,
in one of the original powers in baseball. But one of the things that the New York Times had quoted him is when they set up the minor leagues back in the 1920s, he referred to it as the bus league. And he said, what does that mean? He says, we can't set up a league where teams can't get to and from without a bus.
Right.
So you had the New York Penn League, you had the Southern Circuit, you had various places, the Midwest Conference. You had places where a 2-hour bus ride, you could play a bunch of teams.
Right. Now,
obviously there were more minor league teams in those days, but you kind of wonder for travel and for equity, if that maybe a bus league might not be a better proposition for.
It'd be
for
cool.
Yeah. Because a 4.5 or 5 hour trip to Pittsburgh isn't a 17 hour trip to, you know, wherever it might be.
Yeah, Mercer.
Jacksonville, yeah. North Carolina, South Carolina. That's a long trips.
I agree. I think it'd be great. I mean, I think it would completely change things for these teams. And, you know, lacrosse is a tough sport. It's a non-revenue sport. And automatically say non-revenue, it means, okay, don't spend any money. You know, but, you know, you got kids who the love of the game and the coaches the love of the game. And you know, you look back at some of the UDM teams when I first started broadcasting. I mean, that team made the tournament. They played Notre Dame in the first round. And the buzz and the activity, and it brought so much to the school and to the state and to the area. And, you know, I just hope that you know, we can work back towards that rather than kind of going in the opposite direction.
if you look at the kids coming into the program for 2024, I think you would make a statement. I think you would make a statement that the talent might be better than what's come in the last couple of years.
Yep.
Chris has done a better job of finding the players that can play at the ASUN. And I'm a three-year believer in anything. When you move to a new league or if you've got a new program, it takes you at least 2 years to get your feet on the ground. And by the third year, it should be sort of emboldened that you have, you know, your stamp on that program. So it'll be interesting to see next year if the same result comes with better talent. And if it does, then you maybe have an argument about the level of quality and do you look for a new league. I don't think you can move from the MAC to the ASUN this year, despite this lack of opportunity.
Yeah.
Because they've done well in what used to be the old MAC teams. They beat Morris. They play tough. We'll see what happens against Cleveland State. But
I agree with you. I think, you know, you look at COVID, right? I mean, you lost a year. You got the transfer portal that has now is – you know, risen its head, and that's thrown a disruption into the entire system. And so I think unfortunately, you know, someone like UDM, who, you know, it's a unique culture and it's a great place, but you know, you got to be the right player and the right mindset, you know, to come into UDM. And I think that it was just kind of all thrown off over the last 2 years, and Chris did a great job of trying to fill holes, and he did. And they played hard all year. You know, that was the one thing that Chris is, I think he probably mentioned to you too, but he's mentioned to me, kids play hard. It's just, it's hard to get mad at the kids. But to your point, as we've said all year, you still got to have results at the end of the day. And so it's this balancing act. And I think next year, I think, you know, it looks more like the classes that we had before, right? I think going back, you know, to 18 and 19 and 17 and those years in his recruiting classes, this one looks more like those, where the last 2 years have been really Michigan focused, Midwest focused.
And I look at the cliche meter. When a coach is winning, as an old sports writer, when they go to certain phrases, I already know, not that they've given up on the season or their kids, but they're starting to build the hype and the excuses of what happens. In a business that's driven by result, if you don't have result, you have to come up with hyperbole. That's just the nature of the beast, because you still have to sell that same program to a place outside wherever you might be.
And kids.
I think UAD's education gets lost, and how good it is gets lost in the translation, because they see a mediocre at the moment men's and women's lacrosse program.
I agree. I say it all the time. Like, you take a look at the number of kids that are there and the education, especially you look at the kids that go there and then graduate from there. I think that's the one thing we've talked about in lacrosse, where you see, the Instagram posts of I committed to here. And then in 2 years, they're transferring back somewhere near, you know, where they came from in the first place. And I've told Chris this before, I'm like, you know, you should probably start tracking exactly how many of your kids come and stay for 4 years and graduate, because talking to a parent at that age matters, right? Yeah, I got kids that stay. They get an education. This is what they do beyond lacrosse, because they're not playing pro and they're not making a living playing pro lacrosse. It's just not going to happen. But real life matters.
And I think one of the conversations we've had on the air during games, if you look down the ASUN rosters, there isn't a team in the league that doesn't have a national roster. So we've had these conversations about, can you win a championship? Can you play competitively at the highest levels of Division I NCAA from a primarily Michigan-based roster? And I think pretty much everybody agrees that you can't. And on top of that, the other programs in the world, the Michigans and the Ohio States and Hopkins and Syracuse, once in a while, they're going to pluck some of those top five or six, seven kids.
Yeah,
because they, in fact, are playing on ESPN regularly on Saturday.
Right.
And to kids nowadays, that does mean something. It does.
Yeah. No, I agree. I mean, it's, you know, unfortunately, it's a look at me society that we live in, social, driven by social media and driven by, you know, posting and likes and all that other stuff. But, you know, I think this is a transition. I think last year it was, okay, you know what? Well, we didn't have a field, right? And we did, it was coming out of COVID, and we just got to get through the year, and it's a new conference. And so there was a multitude of things that really was adversity for the Titans last year. I think this year it's more sound footing, and now I think it's just talent. And I think I think this is really, you know, next year will be the year, like you mentioned, where, you know, now you get to put your own stamp on where we are coming out of everything that they came out of.
I'll use the sale world and the race car world. I think of IROC, where everybody's got equal cars. I think of sale GP, where everybody has exactly the same equipment when they race. And if I had a magic wand for the NCAA, it'd be interesting to say to every team, at whatever level they're at, UAD gets, this is the same, Utah's budget's the same as USD's. The travel budgets are the same. The coaching budgets are the same. You'd really have equity.
Mm-hmm.
And if you could just make it all the same for everybody, I understand that that's not a plausible way to go, because universities have different opportunities and some are more, have more money than others.
Yep.
If you made it equal across the board, wouldn't that be at the end of the day, the ultimate, you now you got to go out and recruit the kid, because everybody gets the same. And with the NIL, haven't you sort of said to the kids, we're trying to make it more equitable for you, yet we're still spending in some cases 10 times as much in the ASUN at some schools as to what they're spending. Utah's budget is close to $800,000. UAD's is something in close to $125,000.
Right. Yeah.
How do you compete?
It's not a level playing field.
Makes it tough.
It's not a level playing field. And you know, you said this earlier that the education piece of it, you know, gets lost in translation for UDM. And I think that is extremely important. And it goes back to what I said about, you know, where are these kids going from high school into college to play lacrosse, and where are they graduating from, right? If they don't like what they don't, you know, if they're not playing or they get mad or something, they'll just jump in the transfer portal and they'll leave. And so I think you're going to see more and more of that where, you know, kids are in a more dominant position than the schools are, unfortunately, in a lot of situations, especially at the big time level.
Well, I keep hearing complaints about, you know, recruiting, they can do this, that, and the other thing. I keep thinking of the Ivy League, where there are no scholarships.
Right.
I mean, that's not a setback to some extent, but they don't seem to have any problem. They continue to, you know, produce teams and players, and maybe they're recruiting a different kind of kid. Financially, they may be.
And you got to have the grades to get in, too.
Yeah.
Or at least survive, I guess. Right.
We're not going to answer that. Hopefully, as our last show, I just wanted to take the time to tell you how much I've appreciated this year. And hopefully we do the same thing next year and get back at it and a little more consistent. Hopefully, at the same time, UAD is successful with down at Cleveland State this weekend. And John, it's just been a real pleasure to spend time with you and to.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. No. I listen. I had a whole big thing. I'm just going to tell you. I had a whole big thing planned for you. I was going to give you. I had a whole speech written out, and I had a gift I was going to give you, which I'll still give you. But you know, it's been a great. You've been you know, really a bright spot in a season that has been difficult. You know, with you know, canceling games and the season and whatnot. But you know, the one thing that I'll take away from this season is our getting to know each other and getting to work together. And I've learned a ton from you just in your background and everything you're doing, obviously from a coaching perspective as well. So, you know, I'm looking forward to next year. I'm looking to doing more stuff, even outside the Titans, you know, to be able to do some other things too. So I'm very appreciative of you, and it's been a blessing.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And to the end of this, we'll see everybody next year in 2024. Good luck at this week in Cleveland State. And John, you have a good rest of the summer for sure.
Signing off.